my dear friend, Mrs. Ferial Ashraf, Mrs. Sugandhi Kadirgamar, Mr. Yeya, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor for me to be here at this meeting for a variety of reasons. The first reason, of course, was that I was a friend of Lakshman Kadirgamar. We are both Trinitians, and I remember as a middle school student, our hero at Trinity was Lakshman. He was not only an outstanding scholar, he was a great Ruggerite, a cricketer, an athlete, and I must say a much feared senior prefect. So when I took to politics, and he also took to politics, we had many things in common, and I'm very grateful to the fact that for several years we could work together in the cabinet. He was an outstanding Sri Lankan and a role model for all of us. So in this building, which is dedicated to his memory, I think we can all join in remembering a great Sri Lankan. The second reason, of course, is that I've been asked to speak on a subject on which both Lakshman and I were representing the SLFP at weekly press conferences. This was the time when we were out of power. The UNP under Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe was in power. We were in the opposition, and as this book clearly demarcates, he was talking about the ceasefire agreement that was negotiated by the UNP, assisted by the Norwegian government. So this brings back a lot of memories, and I still have a nice photograph by courtesy of the island newspapers where he and I are shown together talking about the CFA. The third reason is that these facts, these opinions, this vision is valid even today when we are trying to find formulas in which we can sustain the notion of a Sri Lankan identity within several communities which must naturally treasure their own identity. When we are trying to find not only the identity of groups, be they Sinhalese, Muslim, or Tamil, but also cross-cutting Sri Lankan identity, which we have to establish if we are to proceed as a single nation in the future. The background to these comments are really with the 13th Amendment. And in a sense, the 13th Amendment marks a new development in the politics of Muslim community in Sri Lanka. It also marks the beginning, I remember, of the Sri Lanka Muslim Congress. Because when Mr. J.R. Jayawardena negotiated the Indo-Sri Lanka Agreement, actually the 13th Amendment to the Constitution comes as a consequence of the Indo-Lanka Agreement that was signed, the Muslims, particularly of the East, were left high and dry. They were not a factor that was very seriously considered in this negotiation in the Indo-Lanka Agreement. That was because as far as the then Federal Party and the 2LF was concerned, the Tamils and Muslims were put together as one linguistic group. In the Vadukode resolution of the Federal Party, there is no reference to the ethnicity of the Tamils or the ethnicity of the Muslims. They are lumped together as a Tamil-speaking group whose rights and privileges had to be established in the context of a majority Sinhala-speaking Sinhalese group. That was the narrative that was there, which animated the Indo-Sri Lanka agreement, which was signed between President Jaya Jayawardena and Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi. As we all know, it was the Indian government, led by their High Commissioner here, Mr. Dixit, who brokered this arrangement. So on one side, there was the Tamil parties, including the LTT. On the other side, there was the government of Sri Lanka, and there was the government of India through its High Commission in Colombo principally, was hoping to act as an honest broker. History will only reveal whether they were in fact an honest broker or not. At that time, the UNP was really represented in the East by some UN peers. I forget his name now. He was a minister. Mr. Mansoor, and also from Batticolo. Well, whatever. And but nationally, the leader was Dr. Khalil. And when the Indo-Lanka agreement was about to be signed, Dr. Khalil and the UNPs of Colombo principally, that was Mr. Devanayagam. He represented the Tamils of Eastern Province. Mustafa, of course, by that time had left the UNP. So Mr. Devanayagam and the Muslim leaders led by Dr. Khalil came to Jaya Jayawardena and said, well, in this, there is a big hole in this agreement. There is no reference to the Muslims. Not only was there no reference to the Muslims, with the temporary joinder of the East and North, as was contemplated in the 13th Amendment, the Muslims would be subsumed, lose their voice in the joint northern and eastern provinces, where if they had a certain proportion of strength in the eastern province, that would have been drastically diluted by adding the obviously large and preponderant numbers of Tamils in the northern province. So on one side, the fact that they were not consulted, and on the other side, their value and status was being in legal terms diminished in this temporarily joined North and East. Now the question of the joinder between North and East, there was a debate. The Tamil representatives insisted it should be a permanent joinder. The government and Mr. Jaya Jayawardena was hesitant. They didn't want any type of joinder. So between these two positions, a compromise was found by calling it a temporary joinder to be followed by a referendum so that the people in the East would decide whether they would remain in two provinces or if there was a majority in favor of joinder would be accepted. In the event that referendum has never been held, particularly because the Tamil community who would have definitely lost the referendum because then the Muslims and Sinhalese would have got together. That would have been an overwhelming majority as against the Tamils in the eastern province because the referendum was to be confined to the voters in the eastern province. So it has been a constant request of the Tamil leaders that this referendum should not be held, though it was part of the agreement in the Indo-Lanka agreement and in the 13th Amendment. The argument that was advanced at that time was that due to conflict, large numbers of Tamil voters had by that time left the country or left the eastern province, and that the original ratios were not maintained. So whatever the arguments were, political equilibrium was there, and finally it was decided to say that it was a temporary joinder. Long afterwards, by a Supreme Court judgment, the separation of the two provinces was read into our law. So it was in that situation that the question of the rights and privileges of the Muslims, principally of the Eastern Province, came up. And I can remember, though I can't quote the exact words, that when Dr. Khalil and strong UNP supporters, because the Muslims were a strong support group for the UNP, came and told JR, what are you doing? We are left high and dry. He said, well, at this time, I am facing a difficult question, a burning question. I cannot help you. You do what is good for you. So that was the position. And it was then, I think, Fariel will know better than me, that a new party arose from the Eastern Province, saying that the rights and privileges of the, particularly the Eastern Province Muslims, had not been reckoned with in the 13th Amendment, and subsequently carried over to the ceasefire agreement. Now, it is in that specific context that Lakshman made these points on behalf of the SLFP. This was the SLFP position in Parliament, in contradistinction to what was there in the CFA. So you have to read these 11 points in terms of the SLFP's response to the CFA. And every week, Lakshman and I, we used to meet the press on behalf of the SLFP and emphasize these points. And what are these points principally? The first is the question of the joinder. It was not in the interest of the Muslims to have a joint North and East. I think this has again come up as a live issue, but at that time it was very clear that the Muslim community wanted a separate provincial council for the East, and as different from a provincial council for the north. The original idea was a joint north-east provincial council. But that was abandoned, and today we have two provincial councils, one for the east and one for the north. So today, in a sense, we can be happy from a Muslim perspective that one of the primary criticisms of the Indo-Lanka Agreement, that is the abandonment of the rights of the Muslims in terms of the rights to a provincial council, has now been confirmed. And I think in the constitution-making process, it will be our position that this separate Eastern Provincial Council and Northern Provincial Council should remain. I believe that will be the position of the Muslim community as well. That is a very important consideration. Now, the second consideration that Lakshman adverted to was, in a sense, derived from what I have said earlier, that there was no specific Muslim representation in the discussions up to that time. The argument was, okay, they are part of the UNP, or they are part of the SLFP, part of these national parties, so that the ethnic interest would be portrayed or presented by those Muslims or Tamils, as the case may be, within the national party. That was the logic of the argument. So I must say, in fairness to Mr. Ashraf and Mrs. Ashraf, that they never looked at on it as only a spokesperson of the Muslims. As she rightly said now, the Muslim Congress was first looked upon as a spokesman of the whole East, not only of the Muslims. And later, It was the intention of Mr. Ashraf that even the name SLMC was changed to what was the party?
National Unity Alliance.
National Unity Alliance. So that it was Mr. Ashraf's, I must say, very creative approach to this problem, that you should have a party which may have originated with the Muslims, as for example, the Singhala Mahasabha originated with the Sinhalese, and Tamil Congress originated with the Tamils. There was nothing to prevent a party that was starting as a Muslim party, but later growing, expanding, evolving into a national party. I think it was a brilliant idea and a very bold idea, because till that time, Muslims never thought that they could think of themselves as the nucleus of a national party. On the other side, it was the other way around, that they thought that they were constituents, smaller constituents of a national party. So this was a very bold and original idea. Unfortunately, he did not live to see it expand, though, for example, with an alliance with the Liberal Party, with so many Sinhalese candidates in the Sinhalese areas, he was working towards that. That may have cost him some Muslim votes. Some others in the party probably wouldn't have liked that evolution of the Muslim Congress. I don't know, but that can happen. But he was determined to go on that path. So some of the conditions that Lakshman referred to were already met in these new political formations. Then, as far as the evolution of Muslim thinking, part of it is in these 11 points, but the other one is part of my own thinking, I must say. I'm influenced by, there's a brilliant book by Aisha Jalal, who is a professor at Harvard, called The Sole Representative. That is, it's a biography of Mr. Jinnah. Now, in a sense, the Muslims in India, in pre-independent India, were like the, to some extent, not 100%, but a bit like the Muslim community in Sri Lanka. Because unlike the other two communities, there are two faces to the Muslim community in Sri Lanka. They are a majority in certain areas, in Muslim dominant areas. But in all other areas, either in the north and in the south, the north, of course, the LTT eliminated them ruthlessly. That's how the other problem of people living in Putlam for 20 odd years after leaving their homeland came about. But like the Muslim community in India, they had a dilemma. What are the powers to be devolved in their own strongholds? And what are the powers to be shared when they are a minority? When you are a minority, you shout for more powers on equitable grounds. But when you are a majority, the majority wants to draw more power to itself. So the Muslim community is always caught up in this dilemma of being a minority in certain areas and a majority in others, so that policy has to be evolved to give you some strength in your dominant areas, but also not to be neglected in the non-dominant areas. And that was the dilemma that Jinnah faced. And in the failure of that dilemma, solving that dilemma, Aisha Jalal, Professor Jalal argues that that led to the birth of Pakistan, much against the will of Jinnah. It's very clear. He said, I don't want this moth-eaten Pakistan. That is not what he wanted. Originally, Jinnah wanted the whole of Bengal, whole of Punjab. But in the award, what happened was those two, the large states of India, were bifurcated. What was called Bengal, part of Bengal, remained in the Indian Union. And the other part, which was called East Bengal, which later evolved into Bangladesh, went to Pakistan at that stage. Punjab was divided into two, the Indian sector and the Muslim sector. And even more tragically, Kashmir was broken into two, Azad Kashmir and Indian Kashmir, which is even today as we are speaking, a major problem, which is like the problem in Sri Lanka, the ethnic problem in Sri Lanka, the ethnic problem in India has pulled back both countries from growth. Their rate of growth would have been much faster. Country would have been much happier if that problem had been resolved. So now, since independence, the problem of Kashmir in India has been a running sore. It was a running sore in Sri Lanka for 30 years. So this is some of the problems, some of the dilemmas, very serious problems that affect Muslims in Sri Lanka. But we come to another point, which Lakshman symbolized so very well. Because whatever our ethnicity, whether you are a Muslim or a Tamil or Sinhalese, the existential reality is that we have to live together. Whether we like it or not, we all have to cooperate and live together. The famous poet Auden, Auden poet Auden said, we have to love each other or die. That's the line of his poetry. We have to love each other or die. Because if you don't come together on our Sri Lankan identity, irrespective of our ethnic considerations, I don't think it is valid to say that you must erase all those, your own cultural characteristics, religious characteristics, so many markers which delineate a particular community. That is just a sort of very Western liberal idea, but it's not working in Asia. It's not working in Sri Lanka. We have to find another model where each community can certainly, should cherish and develop their own ethnic characteristics, their own religion, but not at the expense of totally obliterating our relationships and our lifelong confidence in each other as a Sri Lankan community. So as today, the existential reality is that all communities must get together to establish those links which will create a Sri Lankan identity while at the same time retaining your own ethnicity. So Lakshman, I think, if I may look at modern Sri Lanka, perhaps the person who best, and I don't want to qualify that word, absolutely the best person who symbolized the Sri Lankan character, the Sri Lankan nature, while each community can retain its own character. So one may be a Muslim, one may be a Sinhalese, one may be a Tamil, but all of us can be a Lakshman Kadirgamar. Because irrespective of your birth characteristics, birth status, birth community, birth religion, because actually, as Sugandhi will say, he had all those minds. He was a Tamil, he was a Christian, he also came from a small elite group in Colombo. So in that sense, he was the most non-representative of people. But he could reach out to all those vast mass of people who were a far cry from his own ethnicity. So in spite of his elite status, in spite of his ethnicity, in spite of his religion, in spite of his foreign travels, all that, he was still able to be the symbol of Sri Lankan identity, which all communities accept. Our meeting today itself is a tribute to that. It's a recognition that we must all try to be like Lakshman Kadirgamar. Lakshman, I must say, that's the type of product of Trinity College. Because in school, we never had all these problems, whether you came from this community or that community. Even though it was a Christian school, it was never trying to impose its ideas on the others. I may be somewhat prejudiced because I'm also an old Trinitian, but I think we can all, irrespective of our community, try to be another Lakshman Kadirgamar. So thank you very much, and I hope we can all look at the life and the death of Lakshman Kadirgamar, a man who gave his life. He never compromised on his idea of a Sri Lankan person. It was the easiest thing for him. He could have reached out to the Tamils or reached out to the Christians anytime and say, save me.
But he never did that. So that is the Albert Camus, the novelist, says, you can assess the nature of a man by the nature of his death. It is the death, that courageous death, however tragic it may be, that gives us the strength and the remembrance of a very great Sri Lankan. Thank you.